Next item on our agenda, superintendent's report, D.C. Virgo Advisory Board update, Appendix H, Dr. Martin.
Well, you're actually not going to hear from me, but as you know, when we reopened Virgo, we put in a parent advisory, a community advisory board. And that board has been an integral part of what has happened at that school over the last several years. And much to my chagrin, I've never had them in to talk about what they do. So thanks to Ms. Clark, I am going to correct that oversight. So it is my pleasure to introduce the chair of the D.C. Virgo Advisory Board, Mr. Becker Clark.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Dr. Martley, school board members, and New Hampshire County Schools family. Thank you so much for this opportunity to share about the advisory board and its uniqueness and how it has supported D.C. Virgo over the past couple years. I think I chose a specific type of quote that kind of fits us as an advisory board, and the advisory board not only consists of the members that were reported by the school board and the VRC, but it also consists of the community partnerships that we've been able to forge with them. And so alone we can do so little, together we can do so much. All right, my name is Rebecca Clark, and I'm actually the present advisory board chair, and I've been appointed since 2014, voted by the members. I actually was one of the six original teachers that were hired at D.C. Virgo in 2012 when it was reopened. I'm very grateful to have had that experience. And also, too, I just retired 2015 from D.C. Virgo, not because of just the classroom, but because I felt there was something else that I needed to do for Virgo in another capacity, and that's the truth. And it's been fun being on this part of the end, supporting the school's initiatives. I've been teaching healthful living all my life, 30 years plus, and so it's been a unique experience, and I wouldn't change it for anything. Because of that and my teaching experience, I kind of thought that I wanted to encourage anyone that is an educator or a teacher, that teachers are the voice in the student's heart, reminding them that you are of worth, you are valued, you're loved, and you're able. As your advisory board, 2014 and 2016, we've been so very fortunate to do a lot of incredible things on Virgo's campus. A lot of it from push-ins from the school support, from the administration, as well as our community partnerships. I'd like to share a little bit about one of those accolades that we've been able to do over the past couple of years. As the D.C. Virgo Advisory Board, we've been able to revitalize the VRC room, which is where our parents are able to come on campus and use the computers and access the internet for either job-related skill sets or online classes or courses. We've also established a Virgo PTA. We also help support specific hiring of administrative staff. We've instituted the D.C. Virgo Parent Survey Forms, which helped us to assess the school's needs, the community needs, the parents' needs, and the staff's needs. Also, as the D.C. Advisory Board, we are able to do a unique thing for our staff, because one important thing about the advisory board, which I didn't share earlier, because I'm a little bit nervous, but that's okay, was that we're here to support the students' programming, their instructional programming. We're here to also support the staff and administration. We're here to build cohesiveness within our community, and we're here to add in community partnerships, which bring in monies that sometimes, for apparent reason, our programs can't be supported by. So with that being said, we actually have been able to support a month-to-month community partnership through our partnerships, that a community partnership comes and hosts lunch for our staff. And for the second time this year, we're actually having an adoptive friend of Virgo, which is a unique concept that we did as an advisory board with the help of Donya Rosebrook, because I really want to give a props for that. But basically within our numerous partnerships, each staff member, faculty and staff, and I do want to emphasize staff and faculty, because without your faculty, which is the custodians, the cafeteria help, the school wouldn't function. So they're all included in this adoptive friend. And each person is given a person to adopt, and during the week of teacher appreciation, they're given out gifts, special treats, and then we'll do a luncheon for them. We want everybody to feel part of the pie. Excuse the pun, by the way. As your advisory board, we've also launched partnership with the newly organized DC Virgo alumni, which is now in its second year of existence. It's been great to see the alumni coming to its own. The first former students that actually walked through the doors of Virgo when it was opened and built. And because of their partnerships, they've been very strong in supporting a lot of our students who were not able to have financial support to go to STEAM camp or to attend the African American History Museum. Now, I want to chime out a little bit about this. We have been waiting for a long time, 5 years in the making, to get our kids out of the district, out of the area, to see another world. And I never thought in my lifetime that this would happen. But because of many partnerships and the alumni, we're able to sponsor 45 students and parents, charter buses with the VRC, and they went to the opening of the African Museum in DC. And that was a major accomplishment. The kids had a great time, so did the parents. We also instituted action-based learning, an action-based learning camp, which was an initiative that the board came into existence to do as a support to the first intercession time, and ABL camp is another alternative offered to the students. During the intercession, we actually had 16 to 17 campers that kind of came every day. And I'll explain a little more about that. Provide refreshments, manpower. We supported the alumni by hosting their second annual sock hop, which was great to see the gym transform into the period of Virgo back in the day. It was a blast. Dress up, pigtails, poodle skirts. It was awesome. You had to be there. And I'm going to let you know it's going to be happening April 15th. Will be number two. You're all invited to come. It's just really fun. I'm not in that period, but it was fun. I enjoyed it. I think also, too, we launched our first action-based learning pilot program. And I want to explain a little more about what that is. I know that everybody's aware of whole brain learning and action-based learning, which is also referenced ABL. But basically, we have two sixth grade teachers with the grateful gratitude, Ms. Hill Black, who opened her heart and her mind to the thought of thinking outside the box, supporting those instructional programs. So we've actually have brought a pilot to the campus with the emphasis to enhance cognitive development through movement, improved movement behavior. And here are some pictures of the action-based camp. But with this being said, as your advisory board, we still have personal projects that we're still pursuing. And one of the two projects is still to support the ABL camp that's going to be held, which will be the second year or the second intercession this coming March or April 6th. And as you can see, these are some of the things our students were involved in. And as you can see in the center, we know, you all know, and if that break hadn't happened, I would have had you guys all get up, because you were sitting there for more than an hour, and your brains were, at least for me, I was starting to feel the droppings. So movement's important to keep the brain stimulated and alert. So that's one reason why we want to advocate movement as much as possible as students are learning. We're also going to continue to support the ABL pilot program. So what is ABL? What is action-based learning? It is a way of teaching students and helping them to learn through movement, physical activity, also called kinesthetic, rather than from sitting and listening to a lecture or watching someone demonstrate or show you something. I have a couple of Virgo students who are actually going to share with you their experience of the camp. So it did take over. Okay. We'll move on. Actually, it was a little video clip that I recorded the kids at their last day, and they shared about what they learned from ABL camp. So I'm sorry about that not being possible, but it was really great that during that 7-day period, and the emphasis was focused on really a terminology. Not so much incorporating, even though we offered them, it was a four-part focus: nutrition, physical activity, dance and movement, and a field trip experience. So for us, for the 7 days that we had the students, we emphasized the terminology. What is ABL? What is dendrites? What is synapses? We had them doing the signs. And then they were able to let us know how they felt that what they learned during that time in camp could be incorporated in the classroom. And it was really amazing what they really acquired and learned in that 7-day time period. As the ABL team, this is what we've done so far. And I want to emphasize that this is still an ongoing growing process, but we've been able thus far as of last year offer a district ABL staff development because one, we feel and see the importance of movement as it supports the cognitive development, but also how it helps to support mood and behavior changes. So we're hoping that our district will get on board with this new, with not a new initiative, but with any way to support learning in this capacity. We'll create a shared folder for our ABL teachers so they can actually house and go to the ABL resources as needed. We are now waiting for a grant to see if we actually qualify for purchase of a stability ball because even though coming up, as you see here, this is the new age of the classroom. 21st century classroom involves movement. And so that means with movement, the desks go out and kinesthetic furniture goes in. And as kinesthetic furniture goes in, kids are learning as they're paddling, as they're moving back and forth. So we're trying to support this initiative because we really believe that this will be a major paradigm shift for our county and for our school and for Virgo. And as you see here, we're charting the changes within the classrooms from the pilot teachers. The pilot teachers have been so supportive. They're sharing with us what they're doing. And they will tell you if they could come tonight, the immediate results that they have seen since they've been doing just small strategies. We're in the process of now trying to seek out additional grant to send them to a 2- and 10-day training in Charleston next month, which will kind of get them more into the ABL initiative and the movement. But what they've learned from us, from Meg Davenport, for those who have been involved in the committee, they've already had embraced it. It's been great to see them excited about it as well.
I'm excited about it. This is the kind of table I want for the board. I want stability balls. I'm absolutely, like, totally on board with this. I love this.
I do want to also take this time, too, to chime out and support to Ms. Hill Black that she has opened up her heart to allow us as an ABL committee to come and talk with the staff. Because even though we're actually piloting a grade level, our initial plan is to actually immerse that whole grade level, sixth graders, into the ABL initiative and get them into that and then start grade level by grade level. But she has opened her heart to allow us to come and share the initiative with her whole staff and hoping that a lot of more of the staff members will come on board with the initiative piece itself. Thank you. The strengths of Virgo. I'm going now to take you back in time. DC Virgo 2012 to now, and what I've done is that I've kind of capsulized from the advisory board's point of view, what are the strengths of DC Virgo, then and now? First strength, pride values, which stands for pride, respect, integrity, determination, and excellence, are infused in all learning and life skills. This probably won't work then. I'm sorry. Okay. It's okay. Move on. Get them to pray about things, huh? This would have been a clip that you would have saw of Virgo when the doors reopened. And each and every day, the students and the six member staff would meet under the breezeway. Thank you. We'll meet under the breezeway and recite the DC Virgo pledge. And it says, "We are DC Virgo. We stand together, united as one, as friends, and as a family. We are loved. We are strong. We are accountable for our actions, our learning, and our future." Each and every single day, the 120 students that we had that first year recited that pledge that was memorized. And with that being said, thank you very much. And with that being said, pride values were not only recited, but they were lived. They were instilled. It became part of the curriculum. It still is at Virgo. Our enrichment programs is also a strength in which students have the opportunity to explore potential interests and talents beyond the academic classroom. Parent connections are strong. There's a presence there between the PTO, the PTA, the alumni, Temple Warner. We're just feeling the love of the community, and it's been great. And it's been an evolving process. But as you can see here, we have Mr. Chappelle Green, who actually came with us to a field trip to the Ability Gardens this past summer. The strengths of Virgo: differentiate instruction to enable student learning, and that's learning across the board. No child is left behind. Excuse the pun intended, but it is true, because of its individuality or plan of lesson. STEAM-infused project-based learning curriculum is also a strong, in which we actually have seen connections across all curriculums that our students are learning something about science, about math, about language arts, and about social studies. Students are empowered to value their worth and education. You're now looking at the graduates of DC Virgo 2014. And so they're now sophomores. Some of them are at WEC. Some of them are at Coastal Christian. Some of them are at Hanover. But they're all successful. And that's great to say. I do want to share a sad note, but it is a sad note. Because with me having to have gone and walked with these kids, from the 120 kids that were with us, we lost one of these students in 2015. He was the first fatality of the year for Wake County in a gang shooting. So now we have 119 students that are doing successfully well. And this is one reason why it takes a village to be accountable for our actions. We all have a part to say and to play in that. Students want to be successful and have careers. And I want to take this time to bring up Malik Gordon, who's going to share a little bit about Virgo and his impact and his and how he has been impacted since he's been there. I do want to let you know, as he's coming up, that Malik was recognized as one of our students, was recognized as a feature in the North Carolina Black Film Festival. He was the youngest film producer. He also was recognized as being one of the top three students that received honors in the North Carolina Bar Association, and also was recognized through Corps of Engineers. So he's going to share right now.
Good evening. My name is Malik Gordon, and I'm an eighth grader at DC Virgo. How has my experience at DC Virgo been? I'll start with engineering. My engineering classes have had an impact on my life because engineering has introduced me into new experiences and new people. These influences and people have changed my life in very different but yet impactful ways. My engineering classes have made me think in more creative and unique ways. My entire outlook on life has changed because I have been exposed to things I did not know existed. Thanks to the DC Virgo's engineering teacher, Ms. Schufert, and my engineering teams, I have competed in Rock and Me Sea Perch and Underwater Robotics Competition. At DC Virgo, I have been exposed to great things beyond the walls of school. I have participated in our state's middle school mock trial in 6th, 7th, and 8th grade, winning most effective attorney two out of the three times. I was awarded by the NC Bar Association for a photo essay contest. In 2015, I won the MLK short film contest when I created a documentary on a family member who served in the military. That same film was later entered into that year's NC Black Film Festival, making me the youngest director ever in the festival's history. All of which, under the guidance of my AIG teacher, Ms. Barfield, have changed me and how I view myself and my plans for the future. While at DC Virgo, I have met many engineers, lawyers, and other professionals around the region. I have toured and met engineers from Verizon, McKemmon Creed, Tritech Software Systems, and the Army Corps of Engineers. They have shown me opportunities in our area. They have given me a new desire to strive and be the best I can be. These experiences can also be very impactful to other students my age as well. Prior to attending DC Virgo, I didn't know these opportunities existed. DC Virgo is a wonderful place for professionals to develop. It is a nurturing environment. The staff know they are invested in us. There are so many possibilities at DC Virgo, and more especially doing engineering. It is crucial to tomorrow's society to have these opportunities to provide students like me with the knowledge it takes to want to do well in life. The way exposure to engineering has changed my life is huge, and experiences like mine can change the life of others as well. The future depends on today's youth, and the youth are molded by their experiences. My positive experiences at DC Virgo have gave me a desire to become an environmental engineer and hopefully help solve problems of tomorrow so the world continues to be a better place. Thanks for having me.
To affect the follow-up. Students of DC Virgo have been in community involvement and partnerships, the BRC, the Junior League, the alumni, UNCW, PBD, and so many more. The strength of DC Virgo is its highly qualified staff who care, staff resilience to change, and DC Virgo has gone through a lot of change, as I know a lot of you are aware of. But with that, we have seen staff do amazing things when you have not a lot of staff. Staff and faculty ownership for success is felt school-wide, not just those who teach, our custodians, our cafeteria staff, everyone. Vision for DC Virgo, as a perspective, and I'm going to shorten that paragraph that I have there. Personalization is key. And I think one thing that I've always admired about when I come to the board meetings is how you recognize each student for his talent. You give them time to say their name, where they're from, their habit, maybe why they're doing what they're doing. It shows that you take a vested interest in this person as they come to perform. That's the same across the state, across our county, but that's also felt very, very well at Virgo, that each child feels that their teachers vest in them. So when there's a loss of a teacher, it's felt not just by the school, but it's felt by the students, and they let us know. So again, us continue to look at how we can learn from them, support them, but continue working on the personalization piece is going to be key. As an advisory board in BRC, we want to continue to dream big and think outside the box, to support Virgo's population and its various educational initiatives. As a community, there's a paradigm shift occurring. We're seeing more parent presence. We're seeing a sense of community evolving. Not to put Mr. Bruce on the spot, but I know that Bruce comes out a lot to a lot of our school functions, and he can amen this. It's amazing to see over the past events that we've been hosting this past year through the school, the parents have been coming. And they've been coming bringing their babes. And they're coming to sit and eat, they're coming to talk, not just come pick up report cards, but they're coming for relationships. And it's just great to see that, continually evolving and forming. And that's something that we need to continue to do across our county, our district. The alumni, to me, a very valuable piece because they're our heritage. And their presence signifies teaching the generation by the example of value of education, of heritage, and self-worth. You see them, two of them on duty this morning, as I saw them coming down the stairwell, encouraging, baby, those little coding words, come on now, touch, physical contact. Their presence has meant a lot to the school, and we continue to do so. Community partnerships, and at PTA, we're still going to continue to work on sustaining more school business partnerships, which we have. I'm showing you here actually a little bit of data from our action-based learning camp, and I want to bring this to your attention that this action-based learning camp data was only captured based upon the knowledge of what ABO was and the main idea. It does not reflect that we had these strategies, the social activity that the students did, and then we saw this increase. This knowledge of assessment was based on just their comprehension of the terminology. And so we saw from just terminology only growth. And that's amazing. As I close out, I want to leave you with these words to think about. And actually, I got to read this from my note. Failure is not real. Virgo has had a lot of challenges that would lead people to think it has not been successful since its existence. But failure is not real. When we fall down, we pick ourselves up until we learn to walk. When we don't get the expected results, we learn from it, and we do it differently the next time. We make mistakes, we look for it, and find a way to do it better. When we hurt someone, we apologize and don't repeat it. We are constantly evolving, learning and growing, changing and adapting to become and to do what is good. We're DC Virgo Advisory Board, and we're DC Virgo. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ms. Clark, are there other advisory board members here?
Yes.
Could they stand up?
Thank you.
Yeah.
And the principal?
And the principal, yeah. I think.
Yes, our board, if you're here, please stand. Good. A lot of them have other obligations, but I'd like to introduce Dr. Sue Combs. Would you like to invite Dr. Sue Combs to make sure the board?
Dr. Combs.
You must be proud.
Yes, I'm very proud. And I'm also, Ms. Clark, like, she was able to get me to see her vision, and I didn't think her.
Folks, Meg has been there from the day we opened this school. There was a huge grant from PPD that made this opening possible in that parent room. So I personally want to thank Meg and Stephanie, who have both been there from the days the doors opened. Thank you.
I want to thank you all. I mean, this was a really amazing presentation to let us all know, let everybody know the great work you all are doing. Thank you.
Ms. Clark, I did want to ask you.
Malik,
I did want to ask you one question.
You're an amazing student and a great kid.
The ABL, you talked about it being, as I understood it, between the intersessions in the year-round school program. Did I misunderstand that, or is that right?
The ABL camp.
Camp.
Yes, sir.
All right. All the studies indicate that the more active you have kids, the better they learn, and especially after activity, then if you go through some teaching, that they seem to retain it much better. So my question is this: how much is ABL being applied during the rest of the school year, during the school day, getting students up, getting them moving around, getting them active, even if it's only for, like, you know, 4 or 5 minutes, and then trying to teach a lesson, then maybe have some more motion and move them? I just wondered, because that all the studies seem to indicate that that has a direct impact on learning, so I'm just asking.
Thank you for the question. First part of your question is, one, with the action-based learning camp, we introduce the students to the terminology. With the ABL pilot initiative, we actually are immersing them into the strategies. So presently, right now, our sixth grade pilot grade level teachers are doing the ABL strategies. They are, and I know that I may not quote this correctly, but I know that with their lesson plans, they're merging the ABL initiative strategies into their lesson plans, in which, and these two teachers are a science and a math teacher. Unfortunately, with these two teachers, they are aware that after 17 minutes, and the kids are too, that if they're not up and moving, they're gonna go to sleep. So the teachers have decided to do brain breaks. So before an assessment, they may get up, they literally may run around the room. Honestly, they've done that, actually. But they may do midline crossing, right over left to toes, to get the kids up and learning, up and moving. So they have taken what little bit they now know about that and applied it. And all honestly, the STEAM project-based learning, which is inquiry-based, skill-based, that's also action-based. When kids are up and moving at any point in the classroom, whether for 5 or 6 minutes, they're getting the BDNF development from the big muscles, and so they're moving. So that's great. But we're trying to promote longevity of that movement. So the more that they're engaged in movement consistently as they're learning, the better they will be. And that's the goal of us wanting to strive to implement the whole immersion process, to bring in the equipment, to bring in stability balls. Because right now we're starting small. Stability balls are a great way. They've been proven research-based by Guillaume and also through a research that I studied out that when students are moving and bouncing, they're using the legs, and they're still learning as they're on the ball. So we started small with the stability balls, and we're gonna work our way up. So with that being said, not enough's being done. And that could be due to time restraints, lack of information, which is one reason why we want to educate and immerse this student to our staff. But even more importantly, we want to bring it to the district because we see it across the board. Having to have taught high school for 18 years and having to be a helpful living teacher and having to have gone through a grant that had a wellness center and having kids that I document and tracked, that when they left the wellness center and went to class, we saw major differences in their academic achievement. When the gym was open up first thing in the morning and they came in and walked around and jogged and talked before going to the cafeteria and sitting down, we saw major differences in academic retention. So yes, there's a strong connection.
I remember reading Jenkins' book, his second book, and he talks about getting kids up and marching them around, you know, mm-hmm. getting them to move around. And I remember when I read it, I thought, this is weird, this is strange. But since that time, I have seen some studies that do indicate, I mean, students do better after the lunch period and such as that. So, you know, I encourage at DC Virgo, at least as a pilot, that you do as much of that because it may well be that 5 minutes taken here may result in what would take 20 minutes of teaching.
Absolutely.
Over here. So I do congratulate you on that, and I do hope DC Virgo becomes very active in getting their students up and moving and all that goes with that.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Anyone else? Questions?
Bruce? I just would like to make one comment. You saw a lot of passion here tonight, and I had the benefit. Sabrina invited me to her first teacher's meeting, I guess you call it, and there's passion all throughout Virgo. And they're trying to change lives one day at a time, and it's quite impressive. I encourage you to visit, and I think you'll see it. But thank you so
thank
much
you.
For what you did.
Thank you so much.
Hey. Anything else? Next item on our agenda is consensus items, personnel, appendix I. Dr. Hahn.
Thank you. Request that the board approve the personnel list, appendix I.
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It is approved. Next item, budget amendments, appendix J. Mary Hazel Small.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I request the board's approval of the amendments presented.
Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Need a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It is approved. Third item, change of school assignments, appendix K, Dr. Holliday.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members of the board, request that you release these students to a neighboring school district on parent request as a matter of routine.
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It is approved. Next item, new business. D.
design selection for various 2014 bond projects, Appendix L. Eddie Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Tonight, we actually, the pre-selection committee is making a recommendation for designers, several projects in our 2014 bond program, as well as the Southeast Area High School. These are presented for you for approval tonight. If the selection is approved, this will authorize Ms. Lawrence and Facility Planning to negotiate the fees with the contract with the vendors, and those contracts would be brought back to you at a later date.
Move for approval.
So I have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Have a second for Mr. Schell. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It is approved. Next item, resolution to use construction management at risk as the construction delivery method for Myrtle Grove and Rolling Grice Middle School renovation, Appendix M. Mr. Anderson.
Thank you. These are two projects you just selected designers for. There are several delivery methods made available to the Board of Education. We have evaluated all of those and feel that construction management at risk is the best is in the best interest of these projects. Ask that you approve the resolution, which would allow us to use this delivery method at Myrtle Grove and Rolling Grice.
Move for approval.
Second.
I got a motion and a second. Any discussion? Yes, sir.
Mr. Anderson, could you explain why this particular method you think is best?
I think that these two projects are very unique in that they are going to be fairly intensive renovations on occupied school campuses. Construction management at risk allows us to select the construction manager ahead of time and have the construction manager work with us and the design team throughout the design process. So we will get real-time cost estimates. It is a tremendous help in getting to know the building. If we need destructive testing done to really figure out exactly what's there and help make sure that our design documents are as accurate as possible, and which ultimately results in better cost and in fewer changes. It also allows us to pre-qualify the construction manager and the first-tier subcontractors. These are two very unique projects, and we want to make sure that the person managing these projects has had some good experience and good results on similar projects.
Are there any liability differences between this method and the other methods from the school system's point of view?
I don't think there are any different liability issues. The contract is of course, different in how the delivery method is handled, but I don't see any liability differences. This one does set, through the bidding process, a guaranteed maximum price. So it is an open book bidding, which I think is could be viewed as even better than the single prime traditional design bid build, because you know the level of competition, and if we can increase that level of competition, then we should get better prices.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It is approved. Next item on the agenda, consideration of bids for New Hanover High School, Brogdon Hall, asbestos abatement and replacement, Appendix N. Mr. Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This project is included in the 2016-17 capital budget. We're presenting bids tonight for consideration, asking you to award the contract to Janizik Building Group, LLC, in the amount of $89,500.
Move for approval.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Yes, I want to ask a question. I've been on the board for over 27 years, and the first meeting I was ever in, we discussed asbestos abatement. Are we ever going to abate all our asbestos? I'm serious.
Well, I'll tell you that. I'll tell you this. We have abated all of the asbestos that is deemed hazardous. We do 6-month inspections at our schools, and we find, and when we find that a material that contains asbestos is in such a condition that it could potentially present a hazard, then we create a project and we bid that project and bring that to you for award. We're not at this point. Our goal is not to get out and abate all of the asbestos, but to continue to inspect it and bring projects like this to you when they're needed.
I know when in that meeting we discussed friable and non-friable asbestos. Do
right.
we both have two types, at friable and unfriable?
All of the friable asbestos has been removed.
Okay.
There's only non-friable asbestos in our schools at this point.
Are you
okay.
saying friable?
Like friable.
Fry. Like fry something?
Friable. F-R-I-A-B-L-E.
Yeah, that's what I thought you were saying.
I know, floor tiles that have asbestos in them, if they are still solid and everything, we don't have to deal with them.
Mm-hmm.
It's only when they start deteriorating that we have to really address them. Is
or
that not correct?
Or if they break up.
That's
if,
correct.
If they're broken up, we have to
yeah.
deal with
yes.
them.
Yes. Yeah.
That's correct.
And isn't it just paid to be done all during the summer? It should be done by the time the students are back?
Yes, it will.
Mr. Anderson, I know we had talked about tipping fees before. Is it different for asbestos? Those waiving the tipping fees for removal of?
I can verify this, but I do not believe asbestos or hazardous materials
okay.
are taken at the landfill. These would go to a private.
Okay, I
contract.
Figured it was. I'll just check.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of the contract signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing no opposition, it is approved. Next item on the agenda, FEMA resolution for the designation of applicant agents, Appendix O. Mr. Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a resolution that the state and FEMA have asked that we have signed. We are seeking public assistance for damages from Hurricane Matthew. This will enable myself and Ms. Moles to sign those documents.
Okay. Any discussion?
You have a motion first.
Say what?
We need a motion.
So moved.
Well, I thought we had a motion. Oh,
mm-hmm.
I'm sorry.
Motion.
All right. Do I have a motion? I have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
All right, I have a second. Now, any discussion? Hearing no discussion, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? It is approved. Next item on the agenda, call to the audience for non-agenda items. I have had one person sign up, Kathleen Vaughn.
I think she left.
Okay. I have called the name. Nobody answered. Okay. All right. I have here a closed session. Pursuant to 143.318.11A2, is that right, Mr. Bullard?
Yes, sir, it's also going to be personnel, it's going to be A6.
Okay, 143.318.11A6 also?
A2 and A6.
Sir. A2 and A6, okay. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Going to close, second?
Second.
Have a motion, second. All in favor of going into closed session, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? We are now in closed session. We will meet.